Welcome to Second Take, the show that takes a look at the issues behind the news. Eskom's new leadership this week outlined their plans for restoring integrity and financial stability at the embattled utility. Terence Creamer joins me to talk about their prospects for success. Hi, Terence.
Hi, Chanel.
To start with, a new framework has been put in place outlining the roles and responsibilities of the board, the executive and the shareholder.
Yeah, this is quite important. I think we're in sort of a desperate times. And I think in the old days, the balance of power was really shifted towards the cabinet and the minister. And that balance has really shifted. I think if, in terms of saving Eskom, we need a very credible board. And that's what was appointed. And this board is able to, in some ways, assert its authority much more assertively than has been in the case in some of the most recent past, or even in the past at Eskom. And we see that the new chairperson, Jabu Mabuza, who's got comes with a sort of high credibility and high credentials and respect, has been able to speak with the counterparty, the shareholder, and say, look, we need a clear framework of the way our relationship's going to be, where our responsibilities and duties as the board starts and ends, where the shareholders start and, I think, very importantly, ends. Because I think in the past there has been a blurring of roles and responsibilities, and that really has caused some of the problems that we've seen at Eskom over the last few years, some of the governance problems, where the board's role and the shareholder role has been blurred, but then also there's a blurring of the roles between the board and the executive at times, especially around tenders and how those are adjudicated. So I think we are seeing the start of a sort of a normalization of governance at Eskom, which is very urgent. I think there was a feeling that there's a lot of abnormalities in the way Eskom is governed. There's a lot of political interference. And I think that was very important for this new board, if they're going to follow a program of building reputational credibility again and integrity again, they need to do it on the basis of a firm understanding that they're not going to be subject to the political whims of whatever the winds that might be blowing at the time. That they need to be able to hold the line. And I think that was an important message that came out from the new chairperson this week.
The new board and acting CEO also have immediate financial problems to deal with.
Yes, I mean, there's this framework setting, and you know, having the roles and responsibilities properly defined is very important. But this is done in a sort of a boiler, in a boiling environment where there's just no room for maneuver in terms of some of the financial sustainability risks that are confronting the leadership of Eskom at the moment. And the main risk is that before the end of the financial year, which is March, there's certain debt repayments that are coming due, one of which is 1st of February, 10 billion rand that Eskom needs. There's some debt maturing, and then by the 27th of February there's another bit of debt maturing. Well, a big chunk, another 10 billion, so 20 billion in total. And the new leadership, both the board and the acting CEO, Pakamani Khadebe, are having to apply their mind and make very rapid decisions around these things. Otherwise, there's the risk that Eskom will default, and then there'll be a sort of a house of cards effect that you know, everyone knows we have to avoid. So it was. I think the important thing here is that this liquidity crunch has been coming on the back of some sustainability issues at Eskom, but really has come to the front and center because of the governance and corruption, perceived and real, at Eskom. That's really why we're in this sort of liquidity crunch position, because while we knew the financials at Eskom have been under sustained pressure, Eskom's really been able to sort of balance that through borrowings on the back of government guarantees and also some injection from the shareholder over the last few years. But when the counterparties don't trust you anymore, and that's really what happened with the last board as well as the last executive team, those counterparties are putting up resistance to lending and helping Eskom bridge those sort of important periods where they need to pay back certain amounts of loans that they've already taken in the past. So that's really where we got to late last year, where the people or the banks or the institutions or the funders and investors that they could, that Eskom could usually turn to sort of close the funding gap, were no longer willing to engage with Eskom and no longer willing to commit. And that really changed on the 20th of January when we saw the new board appointed, and a board that I think the market feels is credible. And certain commitments were, I think, they were received by the new leadership from funders. Now, we don't know the details of that. That's going to come out very shortly. But it seems like the first sort of 20 billion sort of cliff edge is going to be avoided. And then that will give the board some breathing space to get onto the other issues.
There is also the issue of the future sustainability of the organisation that the new board and executive are getting their minds around.
That's right. So we have these emergency sort of loans that they need to raise. And as I said, I think there's some help coming on the way on that front. But post or into the new financial year, which starts on April, the board is going to have to look at the funding plan for that year, and that again is going to be a very difficult situation. We know that the regulator has only approved a 5.23% tariff increase after the Eskom approached the regulator for nearly 20%. This is on the back of only a 2.2% increase in the previous financial year for Eskom. So they've really had declining real tariffs if you compare it to inflation over the last 2 years, and their costs and their debt are rising massively. So there's a serious sustainability problem at Eskom, and the sustainability of the balance sheet, I think, is really what this new board is going to have to focus on as a matter of urgency. Of course, the emergency funding being in place, and we say we're going to have to take that as given. But once that's in place, really they're going to have to be looking at where do they get the funding to complete the build program up to the end of Kusile. It was very important that they put that landline in the sand, I think, this week, where they can't really be considering anything beyond Kusile, especially not a massive nuclear build program. So they need to, you know, take on what they've committed to and not commit to anything more. So I think that's an important line in the sand. And now they're going to have to look at where the funding sources will come from. We know that government is cash-strapped and have said quite clearly to Eskom that they can't afford to offer anything more. So Eskom has to therefore go to the other sources. Now, the other sources are borrowing, and I think we're coming to the limit of that. We see that Eskom's borrowing is at around 360 billion already. It's going to peak at around 500 billion as they complete the Medupi and Kusile project. So that's think about 500 billion rand, you know, in the context of a national budget every year of a trillion rand, you know, that's a significant amount from an organization. And they're going to have to look at the tariff as a source. There again, the society is saying we've reached our limit, and the users have said we've reached our limit. So there, while the new leadership have said they want to have a fresh engagement and a less acrimonious engagement with NERSA, it looks like there could be limits there too. Although I think they made it clear that they really want to look at the record of the reasons for decision for the last tariff increase, because they can't see how, given the application and the methodology and that frames that application, how they could only have received 5.23%. So there could be a bit of a contest around that. And then they've obviously got the clawback applications for the regulatory clearing account coming up in May. That will, those won't be liquidated during the financial year that's coming, but probably the following financial year. Plus, they'll have to have their application, their multi-year application, for a five-year top tariff path, which will have to come before the regulator this year as well. So there's a lot on the tariff side, but I think we're getting the signal from society and government and everyone that really we're reaching the limit of what we can bear in terms of tariff increases and funding. So both on the, so we've got the borrowing side, we've got the tariff side, which are closing doors that seem to be closed or closing. There may be some room for maneuver on the tariff side. And then you've got the government or the taxpayer, and they, you know, extreme stress that the taxpayer is under. There's many demands on the fiscus at the moment, not least this demand for free higher education, but many others. that can't be, you know, that have to also be addressed. So where does Eskom turn to? And I suppose that's really what this board's going to be all about. And that's, you know, that's where the success or failure of the board is going to be judged. You know, can they find other sources to sustain Eskom and to build it, strengthen its capital structure? We've got a few ideas or a taste of a few of the ideas they're throwing around. One of the ones that they verbalized was approaching some of the public institutions, the state-owned development finance institutions, the IDCs, the DBSAs, the PRC, to see if they would be willing to, instead of holding just debt that Eskom owes back to those institutions, whether they'd be willing to convert that into equity so they become shareholders there. That's a fairly safe option if there's an appetite, and that's a big if, because it wouldn't be seen as privatization because these are state-owned institutions. But then they're going to have to look at their assets, both core and non-core, and see whether some of these need to be liquidated in some form to raise the cash that they need to get through the build program and to stabilize the balance sheet. And then, of course, there's the perennial issue of efficiencies and cost containment. And there, I think, a 47,000-person organization in the context of declining revenues or flatlining revenues, both from the tariff side as well as even worse from the demand side, where demand has actually fallen. So there will have to be some give, it seems, and that's, again, a very tricky situation. Asset sales will be very tricky in the context where people are nervous of anything resembling privatization, and obviously any job cuts would be tricky. So they're difficult decisions. These are difficult balancing acts. But I think this is the situation that the board and the new leadership finds itself in. It's about rebuilding credibility in the market so that if borrowings are needed, they can go back and access, they will be needed. And then it's about really making some really difficult decisions around what the future assets of Eskom are, what the employee complement should look like in terms of this falling demand. And then, of course, I mean, obviously, top-line growth is really going to be very important there. They have to find a way of recovering sales, and recovering sales particularly to those places that can pay, and that's really the industry. And that's really been the weakest point since the tariff hikes, where industry has been, you know, the one where it's been cutting back more and more on their electricity usage. And then, obviously, the other big, big ticket item that they have to deal with and find some sort of resolution is this continual rising in municipal debt in the billions of rands that would really help their liquidity situation, would really help sustain Eskom. How can they continue to be selling electricity and not getting, that purchase not being paid for? And again, it's a problem because that electricity, the consumer, the end consumer is paying, but the municipalities are not taking that revenue or that money that they're receiving from the customer and paying Eskom in return. So it's a really, really difficult situation, one that has to be dealt with seriousness and diligence. So as you can see, it's really very early days, but I think as the winds of change are blowing across South African political landscape, the winds of change are a gale at Eskom, and I think that is a positive for everyone in South Africa.
Thank you. That's the Second Take show for this week. Thank you for watching, and join us again next time for more news analysis.